His achievements include the establishment of systems of administration and financial planning, which is appropriate for a self-financing, not-for-profit organization, thus minimizing dependence on donors. He is the recipient of several awards. He was elected as a member of the Royal College of Physics, London, Fellow of the Indian National Science Academy, and he is the recipient of the Ambedkar Award of the Indian Council of Medical Research for his lifetime contributions to health research. Currently, he chairs three very important health research committees of the Government of India. They include the Scientific Advisory Group of the Epidemiology and Communicable Diseases, the Health Sciences Project Advisory Committee, and the Vaccine Task Force. Today, he will be speaking to us on the profit of the not-for-profits topic. We welcome you, and once again, I request you to please give us this lecture. Thank you.
Dr. Mohan, for that warm welcome. I am grateful to the director of the NIAS and the authorities here for giving me this opportunity to share my, I would admit, rather skewed points of view about not-for-profits with this group. I was discussing the Christian Medical College Vellore with Professor Kasturi Rangan, and I casually happened to mention to him that if you look at the profit which CMC Vellore, which is a medical educational complex, makes in terms of their annual turnover, it's actually more than what the Apollo group make. Last year, with a turnover and our revenue expenditure of 200 crores, our profits were just over 50 crores. But if you look at our income and expenditure account, we actually had a loss of 6 crores. What does this mean is what I want to try and share with you over the next 45 minutes or so. And I am quite open, if any of you feel a burning question while I'm talking or you want me to clarify something, please interrupt me. I have no problem with that. And in fact, I would welcome that and enjoy it. To understand this particular perspective of CMC Vellore, about which I'll tell you a little bit more later, I would like to go back to looking at what are the aspirations of all forms of life. Now, all forms of life, fundamentally, as a biologist, I consider, has got two aspirations. One is to preserve itself. The other is to perpetuate itself or reproduce itself. Now, human beings, who are also driven by these two fundamental forces, discovered several things, some to the good and some to the bad. Unfortunately, in all these years, with all the advancement of science, we have never really tried to communicate with the animal kingdom. Except that last week, when I was reviewing the latest grant applications to the Department of Science and Technology in the health sciences field, somebody finally has come up with a project to analyze the voice of frogs and birds and try and see how close they are to humans and how they can be trained. And reviewing the papers quoted, it's an approach which very few people have done. What were these things which the humans discovered? The first was that the key to preservation of the individual, the species, and the society, and for procreation, is that you have to have power. And power basically comes from wealth. A small proportion of the humans, particularly the great teachers of the great religions, also said that service to other human beings and animals is also a way in which you would have an intangible power which could help you. But this was not accepted by the majority, who saw wealth as the means to power, and human beings then discovered establishment of enterprises as a means of wealth generation by developing profit. And I would like to share with you my view of how I would classify enterprises. The first group are the for-profit enterprises, and they have, the organizers having kindly sent me a list of the participants, I know that the majority of you come from the for-profit enterprise world, and particularly from the very successful for-profit enterprise world. Your performance is really judged by the bottom line in cash. The second group, which is a large group with two categories, are the not-for-profits. Now, they claim not to have any cash profit at the end of the year when the accounts are balanced. But when you analyze them carefully, you find that they fall into two major groups. One is the self-sustaining not-for-profits, who have an activity which generates income, which they use for something. And the other are the not-for-profits who survive by charity of others. Basically, they stretch their hand out and somebody gives them money, and they are supposed to use it for their stated purposes. Unfortunately, in the real world, it doesn't happen so. The charity commissioners of the government of Britain have laid down very stringent criteria. They say that if you are raising money as charity, you have to use 90% for the stated purposes and only 10%, sorry, yeah, 90% for stated purposes and only 10% can be used for maintaining your organization. Unfortunately, for the vast majority of not-for-profits by charity in our country and all over the world, the proportion is the reverse. And some of you might remember several years ago, India Today had a front page called The Greening of the NGOs. And the fact is that somebody who donates money cannot survive unless there is a recipient. And I had the interesting experience that after I retired from CMC Velo, I went to our neighboring country, Bangladesh, to the International Center for Diarrheal Disease Research as their associate director. And I met the chief of one of the largest donor groups in the world. And he told me very simply, he asked me where I am from at a party, and I said, I am from India, and this is 98, which was a different reality. And he said, oh, you come from that terrible country. So I said, what is terrible about my country? I went to your country, and I think your country is terrible. He said, no, if all the world's nations decide to be like you, and this is 1998, and unfortunately we have changed in 7 years, decide to be like you, we donors would not survive. If there are no recipients for our charity, how do we survive? Now, this is a perspective which, believe me, is absolutely true. Unfortunately, and I won't go into that, the policies of our country has changed. The last group of enterprises are the enterprises for governance and service. This we would call in Indian parlance the public sector. And while we had very distinguished service and governance in our country, again, fortunately, I don't have to talk about it. So I will now try and define for you the basic difference between the for-profit organization and the not-for-profit organization. The for-profit organizations, their primary aim, whatever else they say, is wealth generation. Ultimately, the bottom line is king. Whatever their stated activity is, building cars or making safety pins or whatever it is, that is the secondary objective. The primary objective is wealth generation. But for the self-sustaining not-for-profits, they will have a clearly enunciated mission, and achievement of this mission is their primary objective. And they know, because they are also enterprising, self-respecting people, that they have to generate wealth to achieve this mission, and they have to work out strategies of how to generate wealth. To illustrate this, I would like to share with you the story of the Christian Medical College at Vellore. I was a student and staff of that institution for 43 very short years, and they have two clearly enunciated missions, and all that we do is evaluated against these two missions. The first mission is to train health professionals at a subsidized rate so that on qualification, there is no pressure on them to earn back the investment they made for education. Now, when you consider that at the point of independence, we had 60 medical colleges in India, and today we have, well, I don't know today's statistics, it might have gone up further, but at the end of December, we had 267 medical colleges, where seats are sold to the highest bidder. Now, if you, and they invest probably around an average of 50 lakhs, and in some of them over a crore of rupees just to get the basic MBBS, and then to go on to the postgraduate education is probably another crore of rupees. And this is all in the realm of black economy. And the only desire of these people the day after they graduate is, I have invested 1.5 crores. How quickly can I get it back? How quickly can I then start making a profit? And this is why in the last 15 years or so, healthcare in our country has significantly deteriorated except for the very wealthy. And they don't realize that they are being taken for a ride. So they think they have very good care. This is our first mission, and I'll just briefly say that we have been eminently successful in this. We just analyzed in 2002 all our graduates from 1942 to 1992, a 50-year period. We had roughly 2,500 graduates. 68% of them were serving in India, and of these 68%, 4 out of 5 were working in non-urban centers in India. And this is what we specifically train our students to. There are the needy, there are those who need your care, we are giving you the skills, go out and serve them, is the message that is constantly reinforced, and we have strategies for that. There are comparable statistics from the All India Institute of Medical Sciences, New Delhi, and those of you who see India Today and other journals would see that they and we flip-flop between rank 1 and 2 when they do the annual ranking of medical schools in the country. In 1992, 16% of the graduates of All India Institute of Medical Sciences were in India, and of them, one graduate was working other than in the large metropolitan urban centers. Your tax money and mine is used to maintain that institute, and I think if we really look at it, what we get for that is rather poor. Our second mission is to provide high quality, affordable health care for all who come to us. And I want to emphasize high quality, affordable, and all who come to us. Again, we have various strategies for doing this. I won't go into the details of that. How did this institution come to be? And there's an interesting story behind it. There was an American missionary and his wife who were working in a little village in Tamil Nadu called Tindivanam, which is about 100 kilometers south of Chennai, in the later last three decades of the 19th century. And they had a daughter who left India when she was 12 years old, saying she would never come back to this terrible country, which was hot, dirty, dusty, and people died of diseases. She went to America, was educated in some of the best colleges there, but her mother fell sick in India, and the parents persuaded her to come and nurse her for 6 months. Just before she was due to go back to America, where she was engaged to be married, one night, three men came one after the other to call this 19-year-old girl to come and attend on their wives who were in labor. And she tried to persuade them, "I'll come with my father, but let him attend. He is a doctor. I know nothing about this." And they all said, "Sorry, if you come, something can be done. If you don't come, our wives will die, and that's God's will, and so be it." And this is because, as you know our customs, there are many sections of our society which still don't want men doctors to examine women. And next morning in this little village, there were three funerals of these three women and their children who died during childbirth. This shook Ida Scudder to her core. She felt that God was calling her to do something about the plight of women in healthcare in India. She went back to the States, she talked to her fiancé, and he said, "Look, let me make it very clear. If you want to go to that country, that's your business, but I won't marry you." She joined Cornell Medical School as their first woman student, graduated from there, took advanced training in obstetrics and gynecology, and came to India and chose Vellore to start a one-bed clinic in 1900, 1st of January 1900. And the present 2,150-bed hospital complex with over 83 educational courses in medicine, nursing, and allied health sciences grew up from this small beginning. I was very fortunate that Dr. Scudder was still alive when I joined CMC as a student in 1955. And she was 85 years old. She died at the age of 90 in 1960. But she was an inspiring person who challenged all of us who went to that school to make a commitment to follow in her footsteps. And I know many other people who did that, and I don't think anybody has regretted it. But the transformation from the one-bedded clinic of 1900 to today's large health complex was not an easy one. And it all depended on one key decision by Dr. Scudder in 1942 at the height of the Quit India movement. Till then, this was a missionary hospital. They would run, they would treat people. Dr. Scudder had started education of nurses and lady doctors. The diploma in medicine was the course, and in 1942 she wanted to move on to MBBS. But she made three crucial statements in 1942, saying, if this institution is to survive, three things has to happen. It cannot be owned by missionaries from America and England. It has to be owned by Indians. It cannot be managed by people who come from abroad and run this place. It has to be managed by Indians. And her third, which was probably the most important, was that she said that the only way this institution can be self-sustaining is if it will develop services which the people of India, for them, the choice would be either come to Vellore or go abroad. And so Velo started the first department of neurology and neurosurgery in India in 1947, the first cardiology, cardiothoracic surgery department in India in 1949. Its ownership was completely transferred to Indian, completely Indian association in 1955. And the first director of Indian director of the institution took charge in 1961. And now I am proud to say that the entire faculty are Indian, although we do welcome visiting professors from all over the world. And wherever I go in the world, the name Christian Medical College is very well known in health education and service circles. It has been a very great success story if you look at it, but what does this mean in terms of numbers? As I said, we have 1,589 students each year in over 83 courses. It ranges from the 6.5-year undergraduate medical course to 1-year diploma programs. We have this 2,150-bed hospital, which employs 700 doctors, 1,750 nurses, and 960 technicians, in a total staff of 5,700. It sees 14 lakhs of outpatients every year. And it treats 90,000 inpatients a year. Our expenditure last year was 213 crores, of which we earned 205 crores. Now, how do we earn this money? As part of our second mission, I said we give high-quality, affordable health care for all who come to us. Our policy is that no patient who turns up is turned away except under two conditions. One is if he needs a kidney transplant or a bone marrow transplant, it will not be done free. And there's a very good reason for it, because these all, in spite of what you might read in the popular press, are not single point operations. They are processes which have to be followed by very expensive treatment for the rest of the life of that patient. And we did some calculation and found out that for what it would cost to save one human life with a kidney transplant, you could save the lives of 1 lakh children with pneumonia. When you look at it, it's fairly startling. You're not putting a value on the life, but you are making a choice between alternatives. So we don't do that. But the artificial kidney we will use completely free. For example, if a person is bitten by a snake and comes in with his kidney shut down, because we know that 3 sessions or at the most 4 on the artificial kidney would save his life, and he will be normal after that. The cost doesn't matter, because this is one acute problem which we will solve. Now, to generate this, I said we have 2,150 beds. 8 of them are private beds. And 200 beds are completely free. In fact, the director of the institution gets us statistics every week saying, pointing out any department which has not used their free beds. And that's the only time, if I see one department not using their free beds, I would pick up the phone and call the head of the department and say, wake up, you're not doing your job properly. Now, we worked out this ratio of 40% of the beds should be paying over a period of time, and we let the patient choose the type of bed he wants to come into. If somebody comes and says, I can't afford it and he needs treatment, we would treat him as a free bed patient. But if somebody comes and wants 5-star comforts, that's his choice. Till 10 years ago, this was 33%. And if you look at the literature of the not-for-profits, they advise that a good percentage to spend on salaries is about 45% for hospitals. If you look at most hospitals and you look at the real earnings of the consultants, it usually is 60 to 70% of the total money that comes in, although it was usually not shown in any of the records. So this is how this institution has developed over the years. As I said, it's Indian-owned and Indian-managed. And it's interesting to see how the situation changed. 1955, the year I joined there as an undergraduate medical student, was the year of transformation to the Indian ownership. And it's very interesting to look up the annual statement that year. The total expenditure was 16.5 lakhs. And from the hospital, 5.5 lakhs were earned. And then there's a cryptic sentence, the mission board in New York and London will send 11 lakhs during the next 2 months. The total donation we received last year was 22 lakhs, with a total turnover of, as I said, 213 lakhs. That's the extent of our self-sufficiency. And this is because Mr. Prahlad, whom many of you might know as the management guru, came and did a study for us way back in 1962. And he said, if you keep giving charity the way you are doing now, you will close up shop within 10 years. So we asked him, what can we do to prevent this? He said, you have to improve the quality of medical care you go, because medicine is going to go into a revolution. But he also said you should take depreciation on your plant and equipment as a real expenditure and fund it every year. Because he said that money will be available for you for your development. This is a philosophy which very few not-for-profits use. So from 1962, we have been in our budget and in our annual statement of account, we have depreciation. The up to 6 crores deficits per year we have is covered in this, because last year our depreciation was 23.5 crores, of which 17.5 crores was covered by actual income. Where is the profit in all this? Of our 1,350 beds, which are the general ward beds and the free beds, we have done careful cost accounting, and the cost per day per bed for the whole hospital, excluding air conditioning, is 498 rupees. This is last year's figure. The charge for a general ward bed is only 300 rupees a day. And as I said, 200 beds are free. But the private ward beds start at 600 and go up to 6,000. And there is a printed tariff which will be given to you, which will tell you what you will pay if you are going into this bed, which also includes the doctor's consultation is higher, the charge for an operation, an appendix operation in the general ward bed, we might charge 2,000 rupees, but if you are in the 6,000 rupee a day bed, you are charged 20,000 rupees. And all our staff are full-time salaried. And when we looked at this, where is our profit? Last year, in our 213 crore revenue expenditure, it included 36.57 crores of free and subsidized work. As I said, we charge our medical students 3,000 rupees a year as fee. The Tamil Nadu state government colleges, the fee is 10,000. But our fee is only 3,000 rupees. So we subsidize education. Nursing students are charged 500 rupees per year. Postgraduate students are charged 500 rupees a year. This is because universities feel that there should be a fee charged to the students, because they charge very heavy fees. And so our total educational subsidy last year was 23 crores. So with a turnover of 213 crores of free work plus educational subsidy came to 59.5 crores of rupees. And that's roughly 25% profit. But that's the profit which is not seen till you actually pull out these figures from where we are. There are a few reasons which helps us to successfully run this enterprise. The first one is the commitment, the discipline, the independence, and the job satisfaction of our faculty. It was very interesting. I was talking to one of the auditors who helps our staff file their annual income tax. And he told me once when I was telling him, look, I don't have much money saved for my retirement. He said, doctor, don't worry. I've been doing this for 20 years. Most of your staff, the day after they retire, earn a month's income in one day. Because we have some of the best professional medical people in the hospital. And this is true, and it still continues to be true. But while they work there, they do no private practice. They see private patients, but they are the ones who go into the special wards and bring income to the hospital. If you are in the Department of Anatomy, just teaching students, or you are the most sophisticated neurosurgeon, and we had that, Professor Jacob Chandi was with us. Your salary is the same depending upon the number of years after your postgraduate qualification. No discrimination is made. In fact, we have gone to the extent that in our College of Nursing, the Professor of Nursing gets the same salary as the Professor of Medicine, because nursing is an important part of the whole healthcare operation. So, of necessity, people who would like to come and work here have to be committed to the philosophy, they have to be disciplined, but at the same time, we give them total professional independence. Now, I will use myself as an example. I developed the Department of Gastroenterology there, but I was interested in research, and by 1990, I had the largest non-governmental health research group in India, completely funded by competitive research grants. All that the institution does is one thing. You go find your money, but you don't touch a penny of that money. The money comes to the institution, they look after it. I have the freedom, I need to buy this equipment. They say, yes, there is money in your budget, you go ahead and buy it. So that independence is very important. It's disciplined independence. And what all this leads to is tremendous job satisfaction. The top salary of a professor at CMC Vellore now is 42,000 rupees. It was very interesting. When my daughter's marriage was being arranged, some people raised the concern that, you know, he's in one of the new IT-related technologies. His salary at the moment is only about 35,000 rupees a month. So I said, it doesn't bother me. My salary when I retired in 97 from Vellore was only 16,000 rupees. It's been boosted up there in the hospital after that. But the job satisfaction you get, your professional acceptance, and the way your patients look after you or look up to you is something which allows us, even today, in today's materialistic world, to still have applicants wanting to join the faculty of the institution. The second reason for the success was that we had a clear marketing strategy. Now, we don't advertise. How do we do our marketing? First of all, we identified our clientele. And particularly by the late 1980s, when the for-profit healthcare industry was developing in the country, we said, we need to target the middle class. Give them ethical, number one, affordable, number two, quality, guaranteed, and comfortable healthcare. And if I was showing you a set of PowerPoints, I could have shown you a map of India showing the numbers of patients who come to us from all over the country and from neighboring countries, because by word of mouth, this reputation goes on. But at the same time, when you have 3,700 people walking into your gates 6 days a week for obtaining health care, we have a wide variety of strategies to ensure that they get the care they need with the least amount of delay and discomfort to them. That's part of our marketing strategy, to make it a patient-friendly hospital. At the same time, we have identified a second group of clientele, and these are the people who cannot afford healthcare. Our strategy is that the district in which we are located, we have studied it, large pockets of it, we know the income of the people. And if a young man gets a heart attack and needs a coronary bypass surgery, which costs about 90,000 rupees, it's available for him free. And they know that. So we have a two-track marketing strategy, one to the have-nots, the others to the ones who will give us the money to provide the strategy. The third and very important strategy is that we are self-renewing. There are two fundamental principles we have made, and that is that top administrative posts have to be of necessity, be healthcare professionals. The director cannot be anybody who is not medically qualified. Because only then will you understand the philosophy of the institution. The second thing is that you are there for a fixed term. So you know that you have a five-year period as director to build on what your predecessors has done and hand over to the people who come after you. And when your term finishes, you may very well go back to being another professor of medicine. You may not even be head of the unit or department, because that's also by rotation. So this means all our senior faculty have this tremendous sense of ownership and participation and commitment. So this self-renewing strategy is something which has helped us to go forward successfully. Let me very briefly tell you how we make investment. Because with the tremendous advances in modern medical care, investments are essential in new technology to ensure that you are at the cutting edge where people want to come to you. And we developed in 1978 a strategy which we called the Caring Technology Strategy. Now, caring for people and technology seems to be incompatible with each other, but the success of CMC is because we have managed to marry them. Now, there is this tremendous flood of information that comes in on new technology. And there we evaluate, and this is left to the faculty. They look at what is new, what does it contribute? But then the first important question they have to ask is, will this benefit my patient? How much will it increase the cost of my patient, cost of care of my patient? Now, I'll give you a simple example. It was in the 1960s that automatic blood chemistry analysis came, and I'm sure all of you have had executive checkups which give you this long printed list of gobbledygook with a large number of tests which they say is normal, for which you are charged couple of thousand rupees. It's good technology. But when that technology came, we decided not to buy it because a patient may need one test, but the machine insists that I will do 30 tests. And so if you go to many other corporate hospitals, your blood is taken for all 30 tests, whether or not you need it. And I can tell you that many doctors have the problem when the results come, hey, this is slightly abnormal. What do I do with it? There was no indication as a doctor that you could find whether that, why that test should have been done on that person. So the cost, we then went in for what were then called discrete analyzers, where you have for blood sugar one machine for RIT, till finally the companies came with programmable analyzers so that each patient's tests are programmed in it. So we don't do a single unnecessary test on a patient, which saves patients considerable amount of money. The next point we look at is, do we have trained personnel who can accept and use this technology effectively? If we don't have, can we identify somebody who can be sent and trained, come back, be comfortable, and then only we will acquire the technology. The next question is, what does this new technology replace? And I can show you statistics which shows that when we got our first CT scan, number of x-rays which were done significantly reduced because it was not do the x-ray and do the CT scan, which is the strategy of most hospitals. But if the patient needed the CT scan for the answer, he did not have the x-ray. The income, our income goes down, but patients are sensible and they tell others so that the total number of patients who come increases. And then we look at, will it earn what we are going to invest in it? These are decisions which you as people in the for-profit sector do every day. But we also look at what we call primary earning, which is the cost of that test and what comes from it, and secondary earning, which is better utilization of the hospital. I'll give you two brief examples. In 1987, the average stay of a patient in the hospital was 11 days. Today it is down to 5.3 days. And this reduction has been possible because of the judicious use of technology. Now this also means that for the patient it is better, he gets back home quicker. For us it is better, there is increased turnover. In 1987 we had 45,000 inpatients a year, today we have 90,000 inpatients a year. It brings more income. The second is an even better example. In 1993, we installed the first MRI scanner in our institution. At that time in Chennai and in Bangalore, there were one MRI scanner each and they were charging 11,000 rupees. I did a lot of costing and decided to charge our MRI 6,000 rupees. Word got around that you can get an MRI in Vellore for 6,000 rupees, but we also have the policy that an outside doctor cannot request a test in our hospital. It's done only for our patients. So people realized it was cheaper to hire a taxi in Madras, go down to Vellore, get your MRI and come back. And we actually found out that there was a large number of patients coming. They were all seen by a doctor at Vellore. The MRI was ordered and the result was discussed by the doctor with them. And up to 50% of them decided, we don't want to go back to our doctor, whether it's Madras or Bangalore, we would rather complete the treatment here. So the total patient flow increased. So these are some of the strategies that we have used successfully for investing. And then comes the question, where will the capital investment come from? Technology in healthcare is expensive. But this is where our policy of depreciation from 1962, we have a fairly respectable equipment replacement fund, which we can tap. Judiciously, we use external loan, and we also get investment for capital expenditure from the US government. They have a policy of supporting institutions which were started by Americans all over the world. But the money we get from them, we use for innovative approaches. I'll give you two examples. One was way back in 94, we got $1 million from them, and we used it to recycle our water. We separated all our plumbing so that wash water from clean areas came separate from the sewage and infected water, purified the sewage wash water, recycled it to flush toilets. Now, a 2,000-bed hospital, we actually have something like 5,000 toilets. And it takes a huge amount of water to flush them. And by doing this in 94, we reduced our water requirement from 24 lakh gallons a day to 16 lakh gallons. At that time, the hospital was only 1,600 beds. The expansion was possible because of the 8 lakh gallons of water we saved every day from the total which was permitted by us from the government. The next one is a bit of a joke. There is a lot in the literature about purifying sewage before discharging it into the town sewer. Nobody in India was doing this in 1996 when the US government again said, we want to give you some money for capital expenditure. So we established the ideal hospital sewage purification system. And the water we discharge into the town sewer, which is fully untreated sewage, of course, is excellent quality. But we did this for a reason, because we know that water is going to be a big crunch, and we can, whenever we want, take this hospital sewage water, purify it a little more, take our sewage water, which is now being used to flush toilets, purify it completely, and really reuse 80 to 90% of our water. We haven't done that yet because it's not yet necessary. Last year with the drought, we thought maybe we'll have to find the money to start doing it now. But the rains this year have been very good, so maybe another 2-3 years we can wait before we do it. But when you get money for something, you do things looking to the far future. Let me conclude by saying that I hope you would agree that not-for-profit organizations who try to generate their own income have got a tremendous profit by fulfilling the missions they have laid out for you. But for a group like you, which comes from the industry and similar for-profit sectors, what would be my take-home messages? Social responsibility of industries and for for-profit organizations is something which is talked about very much. My understanding is that most people's concept of social responsibility ends with your lower paid employees. We forget that the profit and the wealth that we generate is generated from the public. Not from your shareholders, but from the public. What do we give back to them? There's a simple, immediate answer by all of you who I'm sure are proponents of the World Trade Organization and the globalized free enterprise. And the answer is that it will trickle down. Let me tell you, in the country where it has been trickling down for 2 centuries, the United States of America, to which, unfortunately, with great regret, I see we are selling our soul, 35% of the population has no access to health care in any form. It'll startle you. I was in Boston 2 weeks ago. I had done some training there way back in 1969. And I drove through the slum through which I used to drive through every day during the 18 months I was there to get to the Boston City Hospital, and it is unchanged. It's the home of the Harvard Medical School, the Massachusetts General Hospital, all the wonderful medical institutions we talk about, and of the registered citizens of Boston City, 42% have no access to health care. And it has not changed in the 35 years between my first visit to Boston and my last visit 2 weeks ago. This is the trickle down, which we hope is going to change this 1.1 billion country. The challenge for the for-profit entrepreneurs is how to creatively use a reasonable portion of the profit with visionary, vocational, not for monetary profit objectives. Each one of you represents a different sector, a different enterprise. It's for you to define your mission. And I leave this as a challenge with you. I believe you need to define your mission of your organization, enthuse your colleagues, and you'll have a terrible job selling it to your shareholders because they only want the money in their pocket. But define your mission very clearly and objectively. And this mission should be ensured to be ultimately self-sufficient. See, handing out money only makes the donor feel good. I had some money, I have given some charity, he or she is using it, and my responsibility ends. Actually, real charitable not-for-profit works means total involvement in ensuring and working towards making it a successful enterprise. This means education of the participants. And this comes even at the stage of planning what you want to do. And if our country had that, the terrible things we are seeing in a highway in Orissa for the last 2 weeks would not occur in our country. And I was very interested. I was talking to a high dignitary in Delhi where I was end of last week about this and asked what is the government doing about it. They said, no, that's no problem. It doesn't block the main highway. It's only a subsidiary state highway. If that is our attitude, my friends, our country cannot change. And if our country has to change, our attitudes have to change. And I'm leaving this as a challenge with you. Before you plan your industry, you need to look at how can I improve this area? Not in my image, but in an image which will relate to the people who stay there, whether they be tribals, Adivasis, or poor agricultural farmers. How can I make them stand on their own feet? How do I use a portion of my profit for doing this? And then when you have finished something and it is self-sustaining, you step back and you would have then designed what is the next step I move forward to. Thank you very much for your patient listening. I have tried to share with you something of the enthusiasm and happiness I have felt during my 50 years of association with the Christian Medical College in Venlo. And I hope you are now convinced that a true not-for-profit, self-sustaining enterprise is as innovative, as creative, and contributes as much to the development of the soul of our country as your enterprises do, which are waving the flag of India very high. Thank you very much.
Professor Mathan. Now we open the floor for discussion and questions.
Please. Can I ask a question?
He's starting off and then you could follow.
Thank you, Dr. Mathan, for a very, very heart-touching presentation. Actually, I would attest to what you have said from personal experience, because I come from Vellore district. My family and we have been grateful beneficiaries of the care provided by CMC Vellore. Now, I would also like to clarify a point that you were repeating, that most of the group here are actually from the government and the public sector. Very few from the private sector.
I didn't realize that, otherwise I'd have talked about my last group of industries.
So what I would like to get your views on is, what sort of healthcare system should we have in India? We don't seem to have any sort of policy of trying to provide high quality, affordable healthcare to the vast majority of our population. We have different systems, we are coexisting at the same time. And there does not seem to be any policy to reach out, provide a particular type of system which will reach all. So what are your views on what sort of healthcare system we should have in India to reach, to provide healthcare, high quality healthcare, affordable healthcare to the vast majority of people?
We'll take a couple of questions before Professor Mathan responds. Please.
Dr. Mathan, that was a wonderful presentation. Coming from the educational field, I was more focused on the educational aspect of CMC. CMC as an institution really has enamored me from the educational aspect. We as an institution, we are in the graduate education, you know, MS level education. I've always wondered how educational institutions can survive without subsidy from somewhere. Now, you say that you are subsidizing, the hospital is subsidizing your medical education. I want to check with you, what do you get out of these students after they graduate? Are they coming back to you to serve you so that you reap the benefits of the investment that you have made in their education?
Ethan, wonderful presentation. And in fact, I heard about Vellore, from many colleagues, friends, relatives. But today, the knowledge how the organization runs, I'm really very, very thrilled. And it appeared to me as if it is a small commune type of thing, a socialistic pattern of organization you build, which is giving subsidy somewhere, taking money from somewhere, and almost self-sustaining governance type of thing. Now, my question is, today in our country, I think thousands of this type of organizations are required in various parts. Do you have any plan or this thing that other than Vellore, you want to set up this type of things in various parts of the country? That is number one. Number two, do you feel under the present scenario, in the national and international scenario, of course, when the if we talk about Nehru government, in a developing country like us, he also took similar approach, public sector, where the profit was not the criteria, all the infrastructure industry was there, and subsidies in different fields where those areas are weak, and taxing more money, tax proportion was as high as 70%, if I am not wrong, which is now coming down, privatization, total open market economy. Under this scenario, how long this type of organization can sustain?
Can I respond at this point and then we can go on? Thank you for the kind words about my former institution. I think I'll first take the educational aspect, because you are quite right, education is expensive. We are fortunate we can have a hospital that sustains education. The challenge to most of the university, and you said as postgraduate education, is how much research can we do? What do we get out of this? How much will it subsidize the education? Now, all you need to do is to look at the United States of America. Their research is primarily what supports many of their universities. The second thing that supports education in the United States and even in Europe is that the successful alumni, and I realize the IIT alumni in America are now sending money back to their alma mater. We have never had a culture of the alumni helping the institution to grow further. And that's because once somebody graduates, thank you, it's good to see the last of you because you are a troublemaker. It doesn't matter, this troublemaker then goes on to be the next Mr. Tata. But you are only bothered about the trouble he gave you. So our basic philosophy needs to change. But the bottom line is that if we look at a country with the widespread illiteracy, lack of education that we have, it has to form part of the strategy of the government. Now, this brings me to the question of the franchising, because I'll tell you the answer to some of the strategy which the government could use, and also about how many students are coming back to help us. The only thing we are unhappy about the faculty of CMC is that we are totally or almost totally inbred. To accept the salaries that we give and the strict no practice rules that we have, it has to be somebody who has grown up through the system. And we deliberately try and cultivate our good students to stay on the faculty. Ida Scudder talked to me when I was a fourth year medical student. And her successors continue to do that. And we have a strategy that a person is recruited, finishing his postgraduate, onto our faculty. After 3 years, when he is more or less clear what he is doing, and also after he is married, which is a very important criteria, we then send him abroad for 3 years for training. It's a very deliberate strategy. And then every 5 years after that, once they come back, they can take a year off and go work wherever they want in the world. Now, this is how we tackle the problem of inbreeding. So the answer to your question of how many come back is that 99% of our faculty are our own students. But that's not our success. Now, how many of you have heard of a place called Kariyar in Orissa? Or Besam Katak? You go to those back of beyond tribal areas of Orissa, Chhattisgarh, Madhya Pradesh, and you will find small hospitals which are manned by groups of our students. This is why I said, of the 68% of our graduates who are in India, 4 out of 5 are in non-metropolitan or major urban centers. That to us is the real profit. I mean, a day before yesterday, I was at a meeting where I met one of our graduates. He actually went to the United States, did a specialization in surgery, worked there for 6 years, took US citizenship, and then he told me, "Sir, one day I looked through some old pictures and I saw some of you where your picture's there, and I felt guilty." And he's now come back. Because he says, "I've earned enough money, I've had my fling." And he's gone to a small place in Chhattisgarh, and he's starting a hospital there. Now this, to me, is our real profit in the ultimate analysis. Apart from the lacks of patients who feel happy, and some patients feel unhappy. I mean, you can't have 100% success in patient care. But there are grateful patients all over the country. So education will have to be a responsibility of the government. Now, I said that my last group was governance and service. These ultimately are the responsibility of the government. Governance clearly is the responsibility of the government, but it's also the responsibility of each one of us who are citizens. Why is that we are working in for-profit or similar to that organization and not representing the real needs of the country in the government? The answer, of course, is very simple, because we are sensible and honest, but that doesn't justify what we are doing. Governance will transform only when our largest democracy also becomes the best functioning democracy in the world. Unfortunately, the government is abdicating its commitment to service in the cry for privatization. Yes, we have world-class healthcare industry. The hospitals in Delhi and Chennai, Calcutta is coming up, Bombay has been there for a long time, can do anything which they can do in the Mayo Clinic. But for whom? The government gives them huge tax breaks. I remember when Dr. Manmohan Singh was the finance minister in the early 90s, he made the mistake of calling some of us CEOs of the large hospitals for a pre-budget discussion. And at that time, there was a scheme that if you gave 10% of your inpatient beds and 40% of your outpatients as free, you are eligible for tax-exempt importation of hospital equipment. And I know that my hospital was not getting the tax exemption, in spite of our doing more than that free work, because there were palms which had to be greased along the way. We would ultimately get it, but delayed and all that. But all the corporate hospitals were getting this exemption, and taxation for medical equipment was 120% at that time. It was 1993 I'm talking of. I suggested, when the turn came for each person, I said, "Sir, I have a very simple suggestion. Why don't you uniformly tax all medical equipment at 20% and take this exemption away?" And he had the wisdom to do it. I think he brought it to 25%. And it meant the government was getting revenue, people were buying what they needed, and the system worked smoothly. So this is where governance can play a part in improving everything. But the government must not abdicate its responsibility for service. It is not listening to Marx or the leftists or the leftists breaking a whip. It is because I am an Indian and I realize that a large proportion of my brothers and sisters in the country need whatever help I can give them. And I am impressed by the number of government people I have met who are committed to this. But it needs to become articulated and accepted that yes, why does the world want us to subscribe to WTO? Because they see us as a huge market. I mean, the population of the United States is 240 million. We have 240 million people in India who can afford to spend money like that. But fortunately, they are still reasonably cautious and wanting to save money, in spite of all the disincentives for saving money that is now imposed upon us. But this has to change. And it has to change by individuals standing up and saying it has to change. And those of you who are in a position to do something to change it, do whatever you can, because that's the only way ultimately there will be a collective decision on good governance and good service. What is the sort of healthcare system we should have in India? I kept that for the last because I'll tell you a secret. 90% of illnesses needs only one medicine. And that medicine is known as TLC. Have you heard of TLC? Tender loving care. You have a cold, you're coughing away, you feel miserable, you want somebody who will tell you, yes sir, I know you are sick, just go home, take this aspirin, drink some warm water, go to sleep, take a day off. But that type of doctors are dead. I do this now because I don't practice. But a large number of friends and relatives and their friends and relatives call me and my wife up and say, no, we want to come and talk to you. And I sit and listen to them. And when you find there is something wrong, you send them to somebody. And fortunately, I have enough students, I can ring up people and say, go and see him. But this family physician approach we need. It is still practiced by the homeopaths, the Ayurvedas, the Yunanis, and all the indigenous system of practitioners. And I have no quarrels with them, because I know that 90% will be helped by them. They need to be educated in one thing, and that is, they need to identify the end point when they should tell the patient, you now need somebody who can actually find out what is wrong with you. And that's needed only for about 10% if you take the whole body of sick. And for that, you need modern medicine. So, if I were to be the health minister of India, I would integrate all these systems. And I would keep our indigenous practitioners, a huge network, they run into the lakhs. But with continuing education for them, training them in when they need to refer the patient, and then a lot of the burden that comes to the government hospitals will reduce, because there's a local government district hospital in Velo, I don't know now, but when I was there, they would see 3,000 patients a morning and 12 doctors see them. So if you have cough, fever and headache, and you happen to mention headache first, you will get your aspirin, which will take care of your fever also. But your cough, he doesn't have time to listen and give you a cough sedative. That's the pressure that they are on. But if we integrate and use these people and then strengthen the continuing education, so that people are sensitive for referral, we would have a wonderful integrated system which would work. It'll take 10 years to train people, change attitudes and all that. And what is most important is that, like they have in the UK, you can't go to a specialist straight away. You go to your family physician first. He then refers you if it is necessary. Whereas here, unfortunately, because of the investments people have made in education, everybody wants to see as many patients as possible, because each consultation is another couple of hundred rupees in my pocket. And that's what is really ailing the medical system in our country now.
Sir, one question is answered. That is, why Velo type of experiment cannot be spread over all over the country in many, many places?
I thought I answered this by saying many of our students have hospitals. Some of them even have specialties in their hospitals as they grow. The problem, basically there is one problem. And we have done this by running a hostel for the children of our students to come and stay in Velo and study in the school which we run for our staff children. You wouldn't want to go and live in a village in Chhattisgarh if your daughter or son has to study in the local village school. And there are really no good, affordable boarding schools where you can comfortably send your children to study in our country. Yes, we have the upmarket Dune school and all that, which is not for somebody trying to run a small hospital in Chhattisgarh. It's for the industry captains to send their children so that they will be in line for great things in the future. Now, we have made a small beginning. It's inadequate. We run a hostel for children, and because it's their alma mater who is running the hostel, and we have two retired staff who are there, who are accepted by the students, they don't mind sending their children there. Now, many of them have said this makes a fantastic change to our life, because we come here to bring our children. At that time, we go to the hospital, pick up a few new things and go back, and we know that our children are in safe hands. Now, why is it that doctors won't go to the rural areas? Ultimately, when you ask them, it is the lack of educational facilities, the lack of recreational facilities. Since I have 5 minutes, let me take off on a slight tangent. The meeting I attended in Boston 2 weeks ago was a meeting where they had invited 60 people from around the world, all of us in our late 60s, but with years of experience, to try and predict what will be the health of this world in 2050 and what are the threats for that. It was a good meeting, because you knew that in any case you wouldn't be around in 2050 to know whether your prediction was right or not. But as we worked on this, one single factor came out as going to be the greatest danger to good health in 2050. Can you guess what it is? Any guesses? Urbanization. And there are graphic examples of this, particularly from Africa. And I discovered something very interesting. There are hardly any studies on urbanization from India. It has not been identified as a priority. Now, I am now working out a scenario in the National Institute of Epidemiology. For those of you who don't know what epidemiology is, it's the study of the natural evolution of a disease in the totality of the community. I was a gastroenterologist. This is my retirement interest. The question is, if you take Karnataka or Tamil Nadu, which has a reasonable transport infrastructure, a good communication infrastructure, tremendous access to information technology, with the new industry going up, can this be, instead of coming to Bangalore and Chennai, and all you need to do, I mean, yesterday it took me 3 hours to drive from Poonamallee to the outskirts of Bangalore, and it took 1.5 hours to get out of Madras, which was 20 kilometers, and 1.5 hours to get into Bangalore, which was 15 kilometers, and the other 340 kilometers I did in 3.5 hours. Why can't we decentralize industry and use our transport, communication, and IT infrastructure to have virtual communities out there, which would provide tremendous opportunity for the rural people to be involved in service industries of a wide variety and transform the countryside? You are the generation which needs to look at innovative strategies like this. Because I did a small study in an urban slum in Chennai, and I went and asked them, why are you here? And the answer was that because we have nothing in our villages. But at the same time, you go to those villages, they are the most beautiful countryside.
The reason cannot be repeated, then this is a, I should say, an accident. Exceptions is a dream, whatever you say. If we cannot make it second, third, or thousand number of this thing, whatsoever is the reason, that is one. That is what I said, how long you will be able to sustain. It will be as a role model, just to remember that there was a velour. And that is what I ask, whether under these circumstances, under this scenario of today's India, do you feel that it will sustain for a long, even if it is one today?
Okay. I thought I gave you the answer to your question. in the small hospitals where our students are working. Remember, in 1955, just 50 years ago, when I went to Vellore as a student, it was a 600-bed hospital. The growth occurred during the last 40 years. Some of these other areas will come because there is one thing that cannot be franchised. We have a wonderful in-house developed hospital information system that we will give free to any hospital which asks us for it. But there's one thing that can't be franchised, and that is commitment. Commitment is something that is inspired by example, and it takes time. Now, there is a model place in Tamil Nadu. I don't know how many of you have heard of Oddanchatram, which is out in the back of beyond in Dindigul district at the foot of the Palani Hills. A group of doctors from the same college has got together and started a small hospital there, which is now a 400-bed center with very good health care. They have now gone into education, and they are doing education without capitation fee. There's one group in Mysore. It's an old hospital, but they are now changing it, and they want to move forward. So the key ingredient of the success of Vello is commitment. And commitment cannot be franchised. It has to grow from within. And that is what is needed. And that's what our country needs also.
Sir, I really feel very nostalgic because in 1971, I was in Vellore for 1 year nursing one of my uncles in CMCS hospital. He was having a kidney transplant there. There used to be one Dr. K.V. Johnny, and there was one Shastri in the nephrology department. Today, while giving your speech, sir, you mentioned about, you asked a philosophical question. What all have we done these so many years to understand animals? Now, this sort of a question normally is asked by very old Indian philosophers.
I am a very old Indian, not necessarily a philosopher.
Would you like to elaborate on that, sir?
So, diverging a little bit from the main thrust of your talk today, there is this ongoing debate about health tourism. There are two schools of thought. One feels that encouraging foreigners to come into India for medical treatment diverts the resources, because there are a lot of Indians who require treatment and the health services, healthcare. The other school of thought is that it is very useful to encourage this health tourism sector because of the tremendous spin-off benefits which will occur and result in much better healthcare for Indians, bring in a lot of revenues, and result in extensive expansion. How would you view this debate, sir?
Thank you for that question, but let me first answer you. A human attribute is happiness. A human attribute is satisfaction. Now, we don't know whether monkeys and dogs and cows and goats have happiness or satisfaction. Why? Because we can't communicate with them. We are trying to communicate with other galaxies and potential planets on them, but we have this huge life on this earth. Why shouldn't we try to communicate with them? It was intriguing. In fact, in the committee which I was chairing for the Department of Science and Technology, was a lot of feeling that this really analyzing the pattern of voice and trying to make sense of it of frogs and birds is not science, But I'm glad we finally decided to fund that project. So maybe 2-3 years from now, we'll know something about it. But you have asked, sir, the ultimate question. And I'll give you a very personal answer. Once upon a time, long, long ago, I was a very bright student. And there was a lot of pressure on me in those days to go for the Indian Administrative Service. For a variety of reasons, I decided no, I want to do medicine, and I did medicine. And one of my colleagues asked me, "Do you have any regrets in that decision you made?" I said, "No, but yes. No, because I know I have had a fulfilling life. But yes, because unfortunately, while we were living in this microcosm of Velo, practicing our high ideals, the world has taken healthcare, which to me and to many of my generation is a vocation. It's something to which you are committed for life, but it's been taken and prostituted as the healthcare industry. And this is not only in our country, it's all over the world. In the British National Health Service, there are no longer patients, there are only clients. And there's a fundamental difference between a patient and a client. A patient is somebody for whom you care. A client is somebody from whom you will ultimately gain some money. And it's a paid fee for service. Now, if the government would say, fine, we will give all encouragement for health tourism, but we will charge you this tax, which will go straight. And this is fundamentally what is wrong with healthcare industry, because it's a nascent industry, it's completely unregulated, there are no checks and balances, there is no peer pressure, and it's running wild. I'll conclude with my last little anecdote, which is about one of my students who finished his pathology and joined a corporate hospital in our country. He called me and said one day, "Sir, I need some advice." I said, "Fine, what's the problem?" He said, "Sir, large number of tests are coming to me, and I know they are unnecessary, because the same patient had the test yesterday and the day before, and all of them are normal, and I'm getting it again today. And this is about 6 to 8% of the tests I'm seeing." Now, this guy had just joined at the beginning of that month, and this was the end of the month. The fact that you don't know is that most corporate hospitals have a quota given to every doctor about the number of tests that need to be done, because laboratory tests are the highest revenue earning thing for the hospital. And so I told this young man, "Look, you have only two choices. You are not ordering the test, you only have to read and give the result, so close your mind and do it that way, or quit, because ethics is absent." And I saw the peak of it when I had a friend who needed some stomach attention, and I called up the consultant gastroenterologist in the corporate hospital in that town, I had happened to be that doctor's examiner. And I said, I'm asking so-and-so to see you. Will you take care of him?" And he said, "Sir, everything will be done." 3 days later, the patient did very well. I went to visit him. And one of the good things about corporate hospitals, if any of you are doctors, is that if you walk up to the nursing station and say authoritatively, "I am Dr. So-and-so, can I see the chart of this patient?" they'll promptly give it to you. It's completely unethical, because they don't know who are the consultants who work there. So I went and took his chart and looked at it, and I was appalled that this man, all he needed was a plain X-ray of the abdomen, had an ultrasound, a color Doppler, an MRI scan, and a CT scan. The consultant heard that I was there seeing this patient, and he came to see NB because he was grateful that I had passed him many years ago. And I looked at him and said, "My friend, if you had told me for this problem you would order an MRI, CT, ultrasound and Doppler, I would never have given you your DM in gastroenterology." And he looked at me and said, "Sir, this is the real world." He has a quota for that month. And he knows this patient can afford it and won't ask any questions. And this is what happens to all of you who are sent by your companies to these hospitals. A lot of unnecessary tests are done on you. Most of them are harmless, but some of them, like X-rays, including CT scans, can have potential hazards. I think I'll stop at that point.
Thank you all very much. May I request Dr. Sharada Ganesh to propose the vote of thanks.
Thank you, Dr. Mathan, for the inspiring story of institution building. There are several lessons of excellence to learn from. There is a purpose, and all the modern management techniques and all things that the corporates use, you've demonstrated how effectively they can be used and how our institution can be built. Thank you so much for that.
Thank you, Dr. Sharada. And may I request Sangeeta Menon to please give the memento to Professor Mathan. So thank you all very much. We break for tea and return for the next session. Thank you.